It's time to put on our thinking caps and interpret the significance of what we've been exploring. Unless it explains, history is trivial. Did you discover anything unexpected this week that needs to be explained? In your explorations of 16th century astronomy, you encountered many different, sometimes contradictory explanations. Interpretations have varied immensely over time and continue to be disputed even today. For astronomy in the 16th century, there are countless factors to weigh and consider. For example, we earlier touched upon humanist scholarship, the Hermetic tradition, and the printing revolution as characteristic themes of the Renaissance. How do these themes throw light upon astronomy in the 16th century, particularly with respect to the stories of Regiomontanus and Copernicus? Second, the 16th century was the era of the Reformation and the Counter-Reformation. How did the Reformation affect Copernicus and his work? How did the Counter-Reformation affect the reception of Copernicus? Next, let's consider some common misconceptions about why Copernicus put the sun in the center. First, the Ptolemaic system was unable accurately to predict the positions of the planets. Second, the Ptolemaic system had no explanation of retrograde motion. Third, Copernicanism was simpler. The Ptolemaic system was monstrously complex. Have you encountered these misconceptions? If a friend should bring them up at a coffee shop, how would you counter them? Why do you think these misconceptions are so widespread? It is often said that by removing the Earth from the center of the universe, Copernicus rejected the anthropocentric orientation of the medieval cosmos and toppled humanity off of the throne of creation. If a friend should say something like this at a coffee shop, how would you reply? It is often said that Copernicus refrained from publishing his views until his death because of fear of suppression by the Roman Catholic Church. How do you think this misconception arose? If a friend should say something like this at a coffee shop, how would you reply? It is often said that Copernicus only proposed his system as a hypothesis to save the phenomena, and he did not believe it was physically real. How did this misconception arise? If a friend should say something like this at a coffee shop, how would you reply? These and other misconceptions continue to profoundly shape modern perceptions of the history of astronomy in the 16th century. Thomas Kuhn, in The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, described a revolution as taking place when a sufficient number of unsolved puzzles or anomalies accumulate into crisis proportions, prompting a paradigm shift in which investigators adopt a different and incommensurable point of view that resolves the crisis. How suitable is this description for the 16th century development and reception of Copernicus's theories? Did Copernican ideas precipitate a scientific revolution in Kuhn's sense? Or was the reception of Copernican ideas more piecemeal, incremental, and complex? Finally, let's consider how the state of the argument stood 70 years after Copernicus published the De Revolutionibus in 1543. 70 years later, by 1613, Tycho had already died without accepting Copernicanism. Kepler and Galileo were still early in their careers. Given the evidence in 1613, which system of the world had at that time the strongest claim? Michael Crow comments that it is an irony of current educational practice that whereas everyone believes the Earth orbits the sun, few persons can cite the evidences that led to this conviction. Put yourself into a time machine and travel back to the year 1613. Suppose you and a friend are now talking about cosmology in a coffee shop in 1613, with no foreknowledge of what is to come. There is no confrontation between Galileo and the Inquisition, no Isaac Newton, no Apollo missions, no space shuttle astronauts. Events and discoveries occurring after 1613 are unknown. So given the evidence as it stood in 1613, where do you and your friend stand on the motion of the Earth? How does your conversation go? What is the most significant implication of what you have learned this week? What is your interpretation?